So Lisp is cool. It was the second high-level programming language. It's still in use. Fortran was the first. And the big thing about Lisp is code data equivalence. Anyone familiar with the concept? So this means that your programming is data, right? You can assign your functions to variables and all this stuff. First-class functions, right? Makes JavaScript amazing. And, we all basically live on this. That was conceived of in this paper in the little clip art that didn't render correctly. That was conceived of in an academic paper before they actually had a machine to run it on. It was another few years before they were like, okay, we can use one of those big mainframes and write our Lisp code on punch cards and we can actually implement this. But it was written as a purely academic exercise and is still in use and still informs a lot of program design to this day. Programming language and environment design, not just programming. So, go back a little before that, we start getting the first earliest computers. Not many people have heard of this one. The SSEM was the Cambridge Small Scale Experimental Machine. Small scale, you can see it only takes up 5 rack cabinets that are in that picture. But the experiment there, the small-scale experimental machine, the experiment they were doing was to demonstrate code data equivalence because, you know, prior to 1950, we didn't really have computers, right? There was a big argument whether programs should be data, right? Data should be numbers, it should be the things that are going through the computer. It's a new concept perpetuated by John von Neumann, right? That your program data can exist in the same memory space as your application data, as the actual numbers and logic that we're working on. That was a new thing in 1948, before we had Lisp, before we had high-level programming. And before that, this is the one that a lot of people have heard of. A lot of people have heard of that. The transistor was invented a year before that. And that's our bread and butter. That's what we use all day, you know, depending on how it's like around a billion of them, you know, we're at several billion on any IC, any microprocessor that you've seen in the last 10, 15 years. And before that, then, was the ENIAC. This, again, is something a lot of people have heard of, and there's no clip art behind that, because that's actually the background. So that was built by the Army to do artillery calculations originally, to do math pretty fast. It ran at a smoking 10 kilohertz clock speed. So that's about 10 or 100 million times slower than modern microprocessors, but it was a lot faster for doing the sort of calculations, for doing artillery trajectories that the Army needed at the time. And this is generally regarded to be the first programmable computer. It was not a stored program computer, so to program it, what those women are doing in the background is moving patch cords around and setting dials and crap like that. So you could conceive a computer program, and you definitely didn't type it in on a keyboard. You write it down on a bunch of diagrams and give it to these women and they moved patch cords around and adjusted dials. You know, other things around, whatever, to tell it what to do, to tell it what math to actually do. That program data, or excuse me, the application data for that math probably came in on punch cards. But that was the first conceived of general purpose electronic computer. So, what did we have before that? Before that, I mean, everyone has heard of Charles Babbage, right? The first computer programmers that thought of this, like in the early 19th century. And not much really came of it. So, an analogy I make here to Western history is the Dark Ages, right? You're of the High Medieval period, you've got knights and shining armor, all this awesome things going on. And way before that, you have the Roman Empire, and that was a high point in civilization. And meanwhile, in between, you know, what happened? The Dark Ages. No one really cares about those, and that's terrible. That's a very interesting time in history. And I would argue that computers have undergone a similar sort of arc. So Babbage came up with a lot of concepts. No one knew how to build them for, you know, over 100 years before we got to what I just showed in the timeline with inventing transistors and computers, super accelerated from your perspective, pace of development lately. But the background of that slide you'll see is the Manhattan skyline sometime in the 30s. And so what was interesting about this period, what did we have back then? Manhattan at the time had a lot of elevators, right? Tall buildings like that were really feasible. We had elevators to get up and down them. And you used to go into an elevator, and what happened? You got to meet this dude. Who's generally a dude for historical reasons outside the scope of this talk. And that's an elevator operator, right? You walk into the cab and say, "What's your floor, please?" Say 12, and you work this little lever, and move the elevator up, and when it got to 12, we move the lever back, and it stopped, and you can get out, you know, gotcha, up and down the price of the building. That's cool. And before the 50s, before any of those things I was just talking about in the timeline, that guy lost his job to this. Right, now you get in the elevator. This was prior to 1950, right? There were still elevator operators after that, but there was also electronic elevator control. So you walk into the cab, you don't have to talk to that guy, you just push a button. And the elevator goes to your floor, or goes to open the doors when it gets there, it has to stop first when it gets there and open the doors, and hopefully not close the doors on you. So we did have this sort of automation, right? We didn't have microprocessors yet. Another example, what I alluded to in the introduction, there were telephones, and similarly, in the early 20th century, you'd pick up the telephone if you had one, and you would talk to one of these women. These were generally women, again, for reasons outside the scope of this talk. And she would ask, "What number, please?" And you'd tell her a number, and she would move some wires around and patch her call to wherever you were trying to call, right? That's why long distance used to cost so much, because you had to pay a lot of these people. And like our friend the elevator operator, they all lost their job, right? AT&T is like, why are we paying these people? We could not pay them, outsource that effort to the end user, charge them the same, and you got this robot instead. So that's a rotary dial phone with a different suite. And now it's your job to dial the number and let their technology on the back end route your call over that works. And again, we don't have microprocessors, so how did this work? And that's what I'm here to really talk about. So how did that work? And there were a lot of ways of doing this, different control systems back then. You know, you can do this with hydraulics. I was talking to Gary earlier, he was talking about ways that we're doing it now with DNA and with biology. I'm going to limit the scope to things I can talk about with this machine that I built, to something that's called ladder logic. And how's anyone here know basic electronics, like at all, play with Arduinos or anything, kind of schooling it right on? Anyone heard of ladder logic? Awesome. This is not commonly taught. I was unaware of it until about 10 years ago. This is taught to industrial engineers, and that's really about it. This is quad dark ages fallen outside of modern consciousness. But it's a pretty good demonstration of some principles and how we're able to control elevators throughout telephone poles with not solid state transistors or solid state. It's a solid piece of electronics with some wires coming out and some stuff. But we're talking about electromechanical ways of doing this. So, ladder logic, I'll show you a diagram, looks like a ladder. This is kind of a shitty ladder, it's only got one rung on it, right? You can see that one element there is meant to sort of schematically depict an incandescent light bulb. It's called a ladder because it's got the rails on the side, and this is what differs from most circuit diagrams you might have seen. You know, a circuit is a circuit, like a racing circuit. It's cognate with the word circle. And there's no circle here, there's no complete circuit, such as it were, but the left rail, from your perspective, is going to be positive 12 volts, the right rail is going to be 0 volts. That circuit element, as I said, is a lamp. And if we were to connect those, I'll show you what I'm doing here, just because this is super hard to see. But on the panel here, we have our 12 volts on this jack. So cool. That's the most boring circuit ever. The power lamp there is exactly that internally. And instead of looking at 12 volts, that's that portion of the circuit, right? I don't need to hook up the 0 volt wire that's connected internally. As this unit was built for demonstrating principles like this. So, like I said, that's a pretty boring circuit. We can make it a little more interesting by including a switch. So again, we have 12 volts over on that side, we have 0 volts on that side. And when there was current flowing, the light turned on. If we put a switch in the way, you can see that kind of looks like a switch, right? You push on it, makes that connection, which is not connected otherwise. We can go into the left side of the switch here. The right side of the switch here, back in the lamp. And it does not turn on until I flip the switch. Everyone see the lights okay and stuff? Okay, cool. Like I said, this is a boring shit circuit. No one in here has ever met anyone who would be surprised by how this works. But it can do some things too. Think about a light bulb not being a light bulb. Well, let's talk about this. Let's talk about the telegraph, right? So, mid-19th century, you could build something like this. You did not have an incandescent light bulb yet. If you had something similar, you can flip a switch, and that wire can be a lot longer than that one. That wire can go 10, 20, 100 miles, right? You're shooting electrons down it. And that's a lot faster than a horse can ride. And this changed the industry a lot, right? We can start conveying information a lot quicker than previously. So, you know, nothing like a computer has a huge impact on human history. We didn't have the light bulb that wasn't invented until Edison. Let's not talk about that guy, right? But that doesn't have to be a light bulb. That can be an electromagnet, right? If you just put something that clicks when the electromagnet turns on, then you've got a telegraph. That's cool. You can do other things with that if you have an electromagnet. You can have it turn the gas to your furnace on. And at that point, that switch doesn't need to be a telegraph key. That can be, say, a vial of mercury that's attached to one of those dial thermometers. You see the ones that look like a clock, right? So that moves the needle depending on what temperature it is. If you have a tilt switch that knows what angle it's at, you can say, hey, this switch should be on if it's above 70 degrees. Below 70 degrees, it should be off otherwise, and then you have thermostatic control. And you can, if anyone plays with Arduinos or modern sensor technology, you can do this in code, right? You can plug in a temperature sensor in your Arduino, and you write some code and say, like, if the temperature is above 70 degrees, turn off the furnace, or something, but it doesn't need to be code. There are these workarounds, right, with electromechanical systems. Already pushed it into this. That I don't care about, it doesn't matter. So this is still kind of boring. It's going to get more interesting. Yeah, that's what I wanted to talk about. Sorry, I didn't have time to annotate my notes. Remember how I said that I didn't have to hook up the 0 volts because the lamp's connected internally? I also don't need to hook up the 12 to that switch. So this top row on the switches is called a normalized connection, and if nothing's plugged into that jack, it's still going to be 12 volts because that's connected internally, and plugging into it just overrides that. So wire this terminal's there, it's so we can. That was the wrong slide. So we can do things like this. So we can put the switches in what's called electrical series. And if you move this to switch 2, I'm going to put switch 1 in my head of it, I can turn on switch 1 and nothing happens. If I turn on switch 2 and nothing happens, they have to both be on to turn on the lamp. So that's the example of a furnace. If you've ever worked on your furnace, you probably pull a panel off, and, you know, there's a little switch in there. That's called an interlock. So that says, and that's why you're literally like this, even to this day, it's an electrical system. It's not done in software. So that when you have the panel off, even if the thermostat wants to turn the furnace on, the furnace says no, I don't have contact from the interlock. So it doesn't torch whoever's working on the furnace, right? My automobile has one of these also. I drive a car that's old enough that it's implemented this way also in wiring, not in software. It's, the car's still behaving this way, and that's probably not in software with all these microcontrollers that can bus through, you know. Anyway, we're not talking about it. You can still do this so that you can't engage the starter unless you have a clutch in, or unless you have it in park. So that, right, both of these switches have to be on to turn the light on, and those of you from a software background will recognize this as a Boolean and. Again, you don't need any software, you can do it purely in hardware. So if you have the Boolean and, we can also do a Boolean or, right? So the switches are scrolling in parallel rather than in series. Closing either of those will allow the current to pass, right? And the light bulb will turn on. I'm trying to actually use the patch diagram. And we go to the Y cable. And now, cool. Switch 1 turns the light on. Switch 2 also turns the light on. Both of them also turn the light on. But one of them has to be on to turn the light on. Great, this is a Boolean or. There's an automotive analogy for this also. It's your dome light, right? If any of the doors to the vehicle are open, your dome light turns on. Doesn't matter which one. It's all of them. It's just got to be more than 0. Again. That's the wrong diagram. Regardless, if we have the Boolean and we have the Boolean or, what's the other basic Boolean operator? You just mentioned kind of in passing, and that's Boolean not. How did this get so screwed up? You'll notice there's another row of terminals beneath these switches, and those are called normally closed positions. So if we go into that, it immediately turns on unless the switch is flipped. So that's a logical negation. Again, done in hardware, not in software. But those are the same and, or, and not operators that you're used to in programmatic flow control. It's going or not. Then if you see, there it says S1, not NC. S1 is switch 1, the NC is normally closed. So it's normally closed. It's normally a closed circuit. It's contacted unless the switch is activated. So that's cool. This isn't really, again, all that interesting. We're just talking about switches and light bulbs and automotive wiring. And none of that's going to get you close to a computer. Just evidence of some of the principles that you're used to in modern programming. It's interesting. And the electromechanical part comes in when we start talking about relays. So remember at the beginning when we were talking about we can make a telegraph and we can replace that light bulb with an electromagnet. Yeah. I can turn on the gas to your furnace or something like that. Clever, awesome thing you can do. People worked on this a lot in the mid-19th century. Is take their electromagnet and have it actuate another switch. So then introduces some new schematic symbols. That armor one is the relay coil, and the little like plates are called the relay contact. And now this looks a little more like a ladder. There's still 12 volts on the right hand side, there's still 0 volts on the left hand side. But that switch isn't really hooked up to a lamp, right? It's hooked up to a coil and an electromagnet that actuates a switch, and that's what turns the light on. And I've actually got a home version of this that you can pass on the nose. Over there.
If anyone wants to play with that to see how it works, look inside there and you can actually see the armature moving and adjusting the context. There's a button for its... Yeah, there you go. Similar to with the switches, we have a normally open, like it's on when it's on, and a normally closed, it's off when it's on. And that's what the second row down here is. So that's the relay coil on the top row. The normally open. Must have wired that backwards. Actually, it's... There we go. So now there's only one wire coming out of the switch, right? That relays controlling both of these contacts and both lights, and one of them turns on the switch actuated, the other one turned on otherwise. So, this gets us another few things that we can do. First with the telegraph, it's called a relay. We're talking about horses, right? When it was horse grim and postal mail, they had relay horses, right? You rode your horse until it got tired, you know, it was a stationary, get a new horse and keep carrying the mail. So this term relay comes from telegraphy, when that signal goes so far down the wire, but you can put a relay there, and relay the signal down to the next hop. So this improves telegraphy a lot, and that's why it was originally developed. We use this in hobby electronics all the time for controlling high voltage stuff off of a microprocessor, right? Microprocessors are 3.3 volts. You try to run line current through those, they'll literally explode. The relay, that 3.3 volt signal, can be enough to actuate a coil, right? But it closes a switch, and that switch can be practically as large as you want. I had someone demonstrate this, and I left it at home. So I started to not demonstrate that. But that's one thing that gets us. The other thing is that this starts getting us towards computers, because now the machine can talk to itself, right? And one switch there, we've already got controlling two lights, and we could have done that in the prior example. We can do a ton of these now. And the ENIAC used these, right, for a lot of purposes. It was mostly, the ENIAC mostly used vacuum tubes to run at 10 kilohertz, but there were a lot of relay electronics in there. You can also use this for switching telephone circuits, right, the rotary dial. It would count the number and find across this huge switching fabric. It would close a connection like that by turning on the correct electromagnet. So, I've got 10 minutes. How's everyone for time? Sweet. Okay, let's do something that looks a little computational then, and this is called, talking digital design with semiconductors, but one of the first circuits you learn about is called the half adder. So let's do some binary math. What's 0 plus 0? We've got 0. What's 0 plus 1? It's 1. 1 plus 0 additions
commutative, right? What's 1 plus 1? Right, we don't have 2, we have 1, 0. Let's ignore the first digit for now. If we're looking just at the least significant bit, 1 plus 1 is 0, right? Period. So let's see if we can build one of these. And that's the circuit for it. But we have not encountered this yet, right? Either of those ones being 1, we saw it by Boolean, or the least significant bit at here is what's called an exclusive OR. You don't see that in flow control for programming very much. I mean, that's never your predicate for a bit. You use it in cryptography all the time when you're doing bitwise operations because it's not destructive. But it's called an exclusive OR because it excludes the case where both inputs are high. And this is how we build that. Zero and zero, we're going to say that zero is no voltage. That's purely conventional, you can do it backwards. But if we set one of our inputs to one, we should get a one. If we set the other input to one, we should get a one. If we set them both to one, it should turn back off. So we've done that math that we have shown there. Someone pointed out that's not the whole story. There's a carry in. Like 1 plus 1 is actually 1, 0. And we can do that because that's just an and, right? We both have to be high, and we saw that earlier. And that's the diagram we're doing, not going to wire it up because that's needless to your time. But if we have our least significant bit there, our most significant bit there, we can do 1 bit binary addition. With a machine that's this big, we can do 2-bit, we need actually 3 of these because you need 3 inputs on the next stage, one for the second least significant bit, both of the inputs, and one for the carry bit. So that's massively complicated, but we can do 2-bit addition on a machine this big with technology that existed right in the early 20th century. Again, not going to wire that up. If anyone wants to come play with it later, I might take it back to headquarters around that anyway, but if anyone wants to explore this further with me, there's a whole bunch of positions on this machine that I'm not going to demonstrate just for the purposes of time. And the last real demonstration I have that gets us close to computing, right? I mean, remember the Intel 4004 that was that big, 16 pins, right? But it did 4-bit arithmetic. So that's quite a bit smaller, but we still have the basic principles, right? Software developers, we have to build small bits and put them together, right? Where people do the same thing. And the last practical demonstration I wanted to give you all is called the latch, if you want from a digital design background. This is an SR latch. And all of these circuits so far the momentary effect of these switches, right? Like they're on touching and they're off otherwise. So the state of the machine is determined by the input state of the switches. And that's not how computers work.
That's not what we can see.
Looking at this, see what it does. The relay coil below the lamp and then the relay contact
off to the other side.
At this point, not hooked up fully, momentarily actually, that switch turns the lamp on.
You can take that into a relay.
Switch, so that would be an OR, right? So if the relay is energized or the switch is energized, the lamp and the relay coil will energize. So now I'll momentarily actuate that switch and I can. Stays on. So this is a very rudimentary formulation of computer memory. Before, the state of the machine was determined just by the input conditions, and now you can put a bit and put it in memory somewhere and come back for it later. That light's going to stay on. This switch is going to turn it off. And off. We have basic memory. This is used in industrial control also, like a garage door opener will do this, right? You hit the button and the garage door starts going, and it hits a limit switch at the far end of its travel and it stops, right? So it's progression before. This is good for elevators and stuff. This is pretty much the first circuit we're taught. If you do study industrial engineering, you're taught this lab logic formulation. So that concludes the practical part of my talk, and I wanted to talk about in more detail some of the legacy of this era of technology. And I talked about telephone switching, right? That's where the money was. First in telegraphs and then in telephones. So Ma Bell and the Act of Congress passed to stop Ma Bell from being such a dominant technology player. They had all the money that determined all of the technology, including this 18-inch rack form factor that this machine is built in. That a lot of pro audio equipment's built in, and then server farms are built on, right? So the really bespoke ones. And that's because back in the 1920s, AT&T was building, still back with manual operators. They were building switch panels for that, and they were all kinds of crazy sizes, and then the local manufacturer, right? Wasn't even a manufacturer, it was an artisan, right? AT&T is like, okay, let's make everything 19 inches rail to rail, put the screws on 1 3/4 inch centers. And this is a physical form factor that stays with us to this day because of these problems that people are facing in the real life. early 20th century for electronic automation problems. Similarly, these actual plugs, you recognize them like guitar or any sort of electronic instrument, those were invented by AT&T and probably patented and couldn't find it. But these are literally the same plugs and a very similar looking patch panel to what telephone operators were using. So again, technological problems facing people, telephone companies in particular, before the microprocessor, have led to some sorts of standards that have stayed with us, right? But this is very similar to JavaScript. Go write a language in 2 weeks because we want our web browser to be able to run code, right? We're still writing it 20 years later. So about this ladder logic, again, if anyone studied any actual digital design or played with hot electronics and early hands, raspberry pies and stuff, it's really quite simplistic, right? It's one-dimensional. So the other side is a diagram. This is from like a Commodore 64 peripheral. It's just like a quick image search kit. And this is what digital circuits look like nowadays. So they're a lot more two-dimensional, and they're a lot more complicated, and the symbols are a little more meaningful, they're a lot harder to read, but that's the sort of sophistication that's come with furtherance of digital design. And then you want to do solid states, that U24 there, that's a 74 series, low rubber shot key, S73, I think that's a shift register. I know that's a single integrated circuit you could buy in the 70s, and you could make your Commodore 64 do similar tricks to this, but like on lights and stuff, and that kind of software was cool, whereas if you're making retro. That being said, ladder logic is also still with us. Like I said, industrial engineers are still taught it because if you're designing an oil refinery or some big industrial process, streetlights, even elevators, to this day still use relay logic like this. And even the ones that don't, even the ones that have been replaced by microprocessor controlled solutions, the people that know how to design for them and know how to tell the oil refinery how to operate are used to writing ladder diagrams like that. So there's actually an IEC standard, that's the International Electrotechnical Commission, I think. And there's a programming language internationally standardized for writing ladder diagrams like that. When we put on a machine like I just got from this brochure on that site, you can still buy these, you can program them like that. Let's just take my word for that. This machine has, I built it, you know, everyone come take a look at it later, you know, you can still buy these components and those design patterns they show you. You can take that and build, you know, take our small blocks and build bigger blocks, right? Soon enough we have a Pentium and then we have a dual core Pentium, right? We have all these modern machines, but they really do derive from technology that for purposes of industrial control, telephone switching, elevators, stoplights, crap like that. All of this was developed basically in the early 20th century, and people could still do a lot with it, right? We did not have Microsoft microprocessors, we did not have transistors. You could still operate an elevator with buttons, right? People were not living in the dark ages. There was a lot of cool stuff, and this was a demonstration of how some of that worked. As a takeaway then, keep that in mind, right? Because Babbage had thought about principles of computing 100 years before any of this could get built. And dude, I forget his name, wrote the paper on Blitz, but it was just an ANAC paper, they didn't have machines to run it on. But as the ANAC, as other machines were getting developed, right, like Turing's work, like Bletchley Park code breaking stuff, there was a bunch of work going on in the mid-20th century before people knew what computers were or how to build them or that they were even what they wanted. So the piecemeal things like this that were developed for other applications, economically important ones like communications, they're just practically important ones, like automated control and being able to put an elevator operator out of a job. And taking those pieces of technology got us to where we were today with computers. So if I had a takeaway, it would be to keep that in mind with whatever your work might be these days. That, like I said, the ladder logic, it might be boring, dumb stuff by today's standards or by the standards of the time if we were working on it, but it became very important and actually informed all the knowledge that came to take place later. So keep that in mind next time you're arguing with Flexbox or something, you guys, where that's where we go and what people are going to be looking back at historically in another 80 or 100 years or so. With that, I'll conclude. Any questions for Jack?
So maybe a really dumb, obvious question. So the girls, like, you know, moving all this stuff, is it literally basically a very more advanced version of what you were doing up here with the wires and making circuits? And,
yeah, absolutely.
You know, it's been a really long time since I studied any of this, but I want to say it was like a mux or a multiplexer or something along those lines.
Yeah.
Is that basically what it was doing?
Yeah, that's exactly it. Switching fabric is again a term from back then that exists. I mean, you can buy a switching fabric from Cisco for like a lot of money, and that's a multiplexer. Yeah, so you have a bunch of inputs and you have some number of outputs, and you can mesh like a fabric,
right,
and you just select the connection to make.
Yeah.
So in telephones, like, you know, the fan out of your last model is a bunch of lines, and then you have to work on the trunk lines, right? It's on the phone at the same time. If you've ever heard of that whole sort of easy thing,
right,
that's because they take 100 customer lines and funnel them down to 10 or so, and shoot them down the far end of the line. That operator will pick up, call the operator at the other end of the line, and say, like, okay, I just patched, or I'm about to patch number two, take number two, and they're trying to call this, and then it'll fan back out on the far side. But yes, it was literally, these are, I'm actually only using one wire in these, telephones use three, and I can talk about that, but yes, it was literally a big panel of jacks like this, and you were connect customer 8437, the trunk three, call down the trunk three, tell that operator to patch to whatever was the intended destination. That's exactly how it worked.
Thank you.
Where did you get your device?
Oh, man. mostly Amazon and a place called MCM Electronics, which is an element 1314, I forget what, Newark Electronics, they're related, so. I had the front panel custom fabricated by this place that was supposed to do it in like 2 or 3 days, and it took like a month, so it was actually putting this together until about midnight on Tuesday. I spent all day of Wednesday putting this together, and then yesterday trying to get the slides together. The cabinets from MCM, and the jacks are from MCM, the front panel's custom fabricated. The internals are mostly from Amazon. They're getting surprisingly good, loath as I am to say it, at sourcing electronics components for at least a hobbyist price point. So, but yeah, anyone wants to come up and take a look at this thing and how it's picked up internally or play with some of those more advanced circuits that I alluded to, like, please do, please feel free. That's what I'm looking for. And again, thanks for everyone's time and attention.
Thank you.